which forces me then to compensate for those kinds of movements with, like, the movement of the chest or the shoulders, for example. So, this is an example of the kind of, and or I often work with very, very basic materials. I just did a production in California using the Southwest American Indian Kachina dolls as a model, and the Kachinas have no articulation, which was fascinating because we were working with figures that had no potential for expressivity in the mimetic sense. And so we were working with that limitation, and of course the result was much more poetic than had we made little totally automaton like figures. However, I have seen, for example, there's a British puppeteer that I've seen recently in Stockholm that who built in some little motors into the figures so that when he places them, they still continue to quiver a little bit. And it's very beautiful, because the movie is like birds, the risk is that at certain moments it becomes too regular, too repetitive, and you recognize that it's a mechanism. But the desire to incorporate something that has that kind of control built into it is still interesting.
I would take it on really quickly, or we'll save it for a later discussion where we develop a bit more. I think it might be better if it turns out, because we're going to have time problems afterwards, we're going to be having to race off to the rest of this evening. So if you don't mind, we can hold them for the next session. And so we're ready for 20 minutes. And then come back for the last kind of bonus story together. And that's what I'm going to do.
Thank you. But then I had this conflict because I really do want to get out of my global conceptual mode and go into something useful. And so for me, playing is that means and just seeing consciousness and all that, very awkward instruments, but it's, I still feel like I'm playing a more career musician for a second, more than ever, as a way of being in touch with that moment that for me is music, that instantaneous, fast, moving moment. But I noticed a lot of people, this question of whether expression and touch are really absolutely essential to doing music. And I can only think of two reasons why they're essential to music. One is pleasure, and the other one is this survival issue. All the other ones are just sort of preferences. The pleasure one is because it's direct. It's something I can relate to directly, and since I value I can base everything on my sense experience, and pleasure being very clear, purely defined sense experience, I can use that to make multiple music decisions. I feel very grounded. And it's not that I don't have reason, it's just that I don't have time. Because like, it leads me off into nerdy things with people that I like to listen to. So if I like it, it's pleasure coming from the So this is the reason I think touch is important, because I've gotten pleasure out of making music that way. And the other one, the more technical reference, is the touch is important as a way around the art in general, because it may be essential for survival, it may be part of what we're doing in the shamanist is keep people in touch with some, you know, more important than I think. So that's maybe that's the issue to start. That's something that's going to work.
Thank you. My tangents, I guess, consist of trying to get a grasp, sorry to play with words like this, on the borderline zone between the human and other things, other more or less automated, automatic things that can be sometimes more or less defined as black holes or living forms, which is why I'm particularly interested in puppetry as an art form, because I think it resides in that liminal zone between living and non-living. And I think Roman can have some really wonderful aspects of that in his historical openness now, and there are also very, very strange and uncanny instances in many forms of traditional puppetry where there are kind of unholy alliances between puppets and corpses. And this is something that occurs in a number of African traditions, for example, where a body is mummified and there's a tradition in Cameroons which no longer exists, but the corpse's bones were broken, and this way this marionettized body could be made to dance an impossible dance to its grave, to its highly Western face. And there are several different instances, probably a lot, but I'm not a huge one from Puppetry history, where we have this very strange and very disturbing interplay between the definition of the living and the non-living. And more so when it's coming through, for example, an African and therefore profoundly animistic tradition. So this is something that's interesting, that I like lining up this archaic stuff with what's going on also in our life, And I think that a lot of the issues about programming, programming processes, programming genetically algorithmically driven processes within a larger work over which you maintain a certain degree of control, this is dealing also with these fringe life forms to a certain extent. And I think that this mix of automaticity, of autonomous material within a work over which you decide to maintain or not to maintain a certain degree of control is where a lot of really groundbreaking art is occurring at the moment. And somebody like Ralph at the back is working on video games and this type of issue. I think it's very close to the school, but I think we've also been coming very close to it without making it very explicit on several occasions over the past 3 days. So let's kind of mean I go from the caveman and the tennis class through to this kind of programming and several automats and these autonomous entities that we are trying politically as well as physically and effectively to integrate into our lives. And the questions that I stole, I'll just throw them back like this. There was one that really, the teacher formulated really well yesterday. When she asked Roger, to what extent can non-human perception be integrated by humans, assimilated by humans? And I think that this is a key issue, because this is what we're talking about. To what extent can this impossible, humanly impossible process somehow be integrated into our thinking, into our experiential thinking? Trevor gave us an absolutely fantastic example an hour ago, when he said that what interests him when he takes the voice as source as material and puts it on his operating table is the fact that, as opposed to natural material, he can screw the causality around. He can mess up the linearity, this kind of chronology that we're embedded in because we're born and die, and whatever people say about non-linear thinking and hypertext, I'm sorry, those people are still in hypertext stories, living dialogue than the rest of us. But what is interesting about these tools that we're starting to develop, which allow us to invert and revert this causality, these time processes, this I think also is a very powerful moment for artistic creations. I'm really interested in that. I think that this non-human issue, these machines that we're creating and the things that they are creating, we are designing them often for instrumental purposes to achieve specific goals. These are machines that are being designed to weave their ways into the fabric of our technical society. They're being designed to accomplish tasks. But these same machines, because basically as artists we're dealers, we're trying to make them speak in other tongues if they do have somebody. We're trying to make them speak poetically. And I think this is where we have to really think twice about this issue of non-human perception. You could say, to what extent can non-human activity be meaningful for humans? Electricity is, well, I guess it's human activity, it's running around our bodies all the time, but mastered electricity and stick rhyming is granted is something that's been serialized in a process, as a process of scale of which we're minimally capable in our bodily forms. So we can see that electricity represents immense usefulness and effectiveness within human society, but then it's meaningful as an instrumental system, as an effective system. But how do we poetically mean? This is the real question. And when we're caught up in technologies that are emerging and evolving incredibly fast, we are in kind of in this stunned, dazzle effect system to a certain extent. We're inventing machines that are doing such stunning things, even if this is extremely momentary, because as everybody's been pointing out, these machines are going to be obsolete before the data is worn off. This again means that we have to stop and think about what kinds of poetic meanings we would like to generate from these issues, and what type of poetic interactions and poetic discourses we want to set up with these issues as counterparts. So, so that was a, I don't know where we go here, but to that. So the body is an instrument when we purge it of its subjectivity. There was indeed a very interesting discussion between Barbara and Trevor. Do you consider yourself as conveying and representing and incarnating the subjectivity when you treat your voice as sound material? And Trevor has this kind of bi-pointing view on it, which is, of course, my subjectivity is an intrinsic part of voice I'm using. At the same time, I'm using this in a detached fashion as a sculpture of this material. So I think that the body and the instrumentality of the body, purged of its subjectivity, is something that we can line up to some extent as an ideal. But then, and the Taylorist body, of course, purged of subjectivity, is a perfectly integrated mechanical effector in a recognized society with its recognized productions and tokens. But this Taylorist mechanics, if it gets anything aesthetic out of it, it has to be used the way Meyerhold used it. It has to be used with the grist of human subjectivity kind of coming through it and making it something slightly kinky, slightly anti-alienist in it. So I think this how much humanness, how we have to dose this this mix, this machinic mix, so that it is still artful, is the real question that we're posing to them. How much humanness or humaneness do we have to retain within the systems that we're building, or within the nature of the dialogue that we're building with these systems, for them to be appropriate vehicles for poetic expression? I think that's a real, for me, that's a real good one. And there's another one that just kind of popped up, but it's maybe been buzzing in the background for a long time, which is I have this way of approaching performing arts as being in themselves a form of defiance of normal locomotor activity. And that sounds a bit clinical, but I did quite a lot of work on surface history, and it's really amazing when you look at the origins of many of the early surface forms, which are really one of the originating forms of theatre, and first of all the other forms of religious theatre that we see coming through the arena. But what's interesting in the old surface terminology is when you go into the etymology of this stuff, the number of different words that are used to describe how people walk, acrobats are people who walk on their extremities, and then you have neurobats, and rope walkers are neurobats, and then you have oribats, or oros being mountain, which is the oracle comes from. But the oribats are people who can kind of do what ninjas do on 20th century film. And you have all these incredible terms for these people who defied normal locomotor activity, and this was their art. And they would consider this being simultaneously gods and devils, because they were doing abnormal, inhuman, superhuman things. And I'm wondering to what extent the gestural virtuosity that we're talking about, this not irrational, but this uncanny, I love that word, this uncanny control of time, is perhaps in a way in the same realm as this abnormal. This defiant activity. We're defying normal systems of control. What fascinates me with the juggler is that the juggler is establishing a spatial realm where he is defying everything that we think we can feasibly do and we can feasibly expect to be done. And this is a moment of existential belief in all of these damned rules that keep our feet on ground. And I think this is why the juggler constantly has to throw high, and this is why, of course, we're easy targets for people who are going to be shooting this while we're watching the ball go up to the ceiling. But I think that these issues of what constitutes normal locomotor activity and local nature is too narrow a word. This would have to be extended. It's an activity that allows incredibly fine control of time processes. For me, that's one of the essences of the artwork that we're talking about. I guess I should stop there. I had written something, but I don't know what to say about it. I just thought actually, and then maybe this is something like it was just a phrase, erotics of distance. Everyone comes to that, but actually, I do know where it came from. There was a very interesting work forum earlier this year, something that followed the Ivy, and it was a mix of textual, purely textual input, far from touch, that was happening over an intensive period of 3 or 4 months. And there were amalgamated, collectively written discourses that were just kind of emerging through this incredibly intense conversation process. It was one of the rare forums I followed that actually implicated people from not just North America and Europe. And so there were people, a lot of people in Southern Hemisphere from South America, not many from Africa, there were people from issues, but there were people sufficiently scattered around the planet for there to be constant input to explore. And it was also being moderated around the clock. So there was constantly stuff being built up. And there were some very interesting moments where there's one woman called Peabody Mandalaman, who's an amazing New Yorker and artist, who did a kind of a spoof on Bach's Fragments of Love's Discourse that Barbara referred to regularly. She twisted it, she pulled out bits of the Bach text and worked in some of her own literary erotica. And the next thing that happened was that some other reader contributed, explored, 20,000 kilometers away, jumped on the text and laced it with his own erotica. And it was absolutely, it was incredible. It was very powerful stuff. This was purely textual. It was incredibly, I don't know the English word, but yeah, they called it pure. Absolutely. And it was just one of those powerful pieces of erotic discourse. And what was interesting was that, okay, this is the stuff that used to happen when the courtly ambassadors took these wonderful Chinese women's writings to the Lotus Council. So this was happening in real time, practically. And it seemed to me that there was kind of an erotics inherent to the communication systems and the speed of the communication systems that we were using. That was an innovation. But I'll let you show you that.
Yeah, let's end it up with a personal thank you. I think I would like to present a little case story. And here is where I'm ending the instructions, by the way. The case story is a story about my father and me and his survival routine. He came from the war. He was a radio amateur. He was a convinced socialist, and he didn't have all the time to raise his kids. So, and there was opinions about that kids shouldn't speak, you know, when all the grown-ups were talking. So the combination of having electronics in the house, like shortwave receivers, and not being able to, you know, have a normal relationship with the parents, like being able to talk without talking, made me angry and also made me not want to talk at all. And so the only thing that was left was the possibility of maybe secretly trying his receivers and tuning it into what was then the shortwave, which was the real with all these telex noises and very funny zooms. And he actually also forbid my brother and me to play with it. And we had a good time in our rooms because we started hiding ourselves there when we were sent there because we had done something bad. And we happily were doing some things bad to be sent to their room and be locked up. And there were very nice moments when, probably when I was about 4 years old, when someone sitting on his knee, the classical thing with him, not in front of a fire or something, but in front of his shortwave receiver, he was trying to answer our questions like, what is this, what we hear? And he said it's coming from very far. And our notion of far was outside of the house at that time. And we couldn't So the only thing we could do is just be completely silent and for a long time. And the only way what we could do then is to steal this equipment and so, you know, to play with it in our room secretly again. And it was forbidden, well, it was accepted a little bit, but then it was forbidden to play with it when we had to go to bed, because of course we slept for so-called for half an hour, and then we would turn them on again. And very often we would fall asleep with these zooms. So electronics for me is not something, you know, that I've chosen, you know, to for an artistic reason or something. It has been there all the time. There was a kind of magic in what the signals would bring, but there wasn't magic in what we were doing with it. You know, we were opening them up, get shocked, connect wires to other houses where your friends were. You know, like it was just a normal thing. And maybe because of all those sounds in the night, because sometimes you would wake up because these sounds change, you would you might have created a world of sounds without me knowing about it. And I'm not even searching that hard because these sounds are still around in my head all the time. Now at some point, I really had to leave home because it was unbearable. And so I had to leave school and not finish this whole education that I was prepared for, you know, like go to the technical university in Delft and all that stuff. So this was like a disaster. And it was also a nice escape. So I found myself, oh, I must tell also that they gave me piano lessons, but it was given by the person who played the carillon in Delft. And he played so terribly loud that I was really scared. So that stopped. And later, on the way out of the house, I picked up Ehlers Belt record, and that was really the sound I loved, and that was a language that I understood. So I loved, there was a way to get a trombone. I still thought, well, maybe I should try an instrument then. And through the factory's harmony band or marching band, I had to play a little role for about a year in that band. I could get a trombone. Of course, I never made it through the second or the third trombone. It was another failure. But I got the trombone, so I remember the day that I walked out of the house with the trombone, with which I couldn't really play. And felt like, oh, now I'm a musician, you know, so that it had something. So even there, it wasn't like a choice, you know. It was not just, I want to be an artist or something. It was just the only thing that I could hang on to. Now, then there's this long line of survival moments so I played trombone, so I started to go to a very almost aristocratic student club where they were playing Dixieland. And of course, I was kicked out of it because I didn't play the styles right. And so, you know, then so that sort of put me back. At some point, I went back home, and my brother and I were living in the basement, not talking very much, but playing for hours with little records, you know, scratching them, completely dismantling the piano, sticking needles in it, using guitar elements to make sound. And we were just playing for days and having more fights with our parents. So at some point, I really had to leave. And then, you know, if you don't want to talk too much, you don't read that much, and you don't think too much about systems, so the only way to deal with the electronics is to touch it. And gradually, I, of course, wanted to make it turn it into a kind of music, because we found out that by playing, we could really play well together. So my brother and I started doing concerts, and later I met a drummer, and like, okay, so I can go on with this whole story for a long time. Gradually, I discovered that there were people living as artists, and like there was a big diner who ran the electronic music of the conservatory, and he literally let me into the back door of the studio, and I could say he was my mentor in the best way I have experienced any mental advice, not wishing to refuse any question that I had and telling me that I should find out myself. And he gave me all the possibilities to work, and then I started, you know, breaking open the Moog synthesizer that was there, finding out that if you stick your fingers inside, you can really play the electrics by being a part of that machine, because you become a wire yourself, because our skin can conduct electricity, well, the rest as well, but the skin doesn't burst. And sometimes you know, we didn't have the time to really fit it in, but we also manipulated ourselves in a situation that we don't have time to fit it in. And we are sort of happy to deal with it, because we all both have our own little survival methods. And those survival methods has also to do with what when you tell the other people around. I mean, how do I make money in telling stories or making music or finding friends or lovers? I mean, this all has to do with this profession in a way, you know? And maybe it's even more important quite often than these high artistic goals that you can formulate in words. And I'm not trying to criticize other people for doing that, but I'm trying to explain that you can live in a total wordless world and heavily hide in the music. And Joel and I are both, you know, having this conflict right now in our bodies that you want to stop talking and you just want to, you know, get back to just this world which has no, I can't even explain it, but it's just, it's much better, you know, it's what it is about for me. So, I do have a question. It's a statement. I will leave it. So, why is it? It's a statement and a question, but I really would love you to answer it. Why is it so hard to explain to a non-performer that during a performance, analytical self-consciousness destroys that performance? So, if you the question is, you can have a self-consciousness during a performance that is analytical, like purely, you know, what am I doing? And as soon as you get it, you distance yourself, you know, like Roman was saying about the moment that his puppets don't want to respond. I also like to blame my machines and other things, but I know, you know, there's something with me going wrong at the moment if I cannot contact them. You know, sometimes the machine doesn't work, but that's a statement the machine makes. It's not a mistake or something. And it's, the mistake might be caused by ourselves. Now, if I start thinking about all of that, or if I start thinking about the wire that is maybe not connected well, but that software glitch that is still not repaired, there is no performance anymore. I'm lost. Yes. Does anyone else
say that? That's a little different. I was saying, I mean, that you, I guess everyone is supposed to agree with that.
No, but I'm speaking about a special self-consciousness, which is the analytical, where you really think it in terms of words.
Mm-hmm. I mean, the symbolizes. Well, I mean, why should I do this kind of cross the term?
No, it's a question of the conflict.
Where are you?
Do I feel a conflict? No, I do. I feel a conflict between kind of slow reflective and rapid. So I go, and I agree that I go back and forth between the states, and the time being strategized and so depends on the thing that I'm doing, and something that develops in the longer term, more structured. And then there's moments where you can do that, and you can do them all. Well, I see this going in and out.
I can see but I don't see necessarily the entry of an analytical mode that gets to fall from grace or something.
No, but
should be that. You know, there may be some people that really want to.
Well, I don't say something here. I don't
Or whatever it is, but it's a very
for me then later after the becoming the choreographer, very interesting thing. That's the moment of creation. You know what I mean? So it's, I would suggest that moving away from it or say, why do we have it? It's there, and it's a very interesting point.
Well, of course, during proposals, I'd like to stay with it. You know, that's why I run myself in that program. And just that's the idea of just throwing yourself in and seeing how you get out. And stepping out is possible when you work with groups of people. And as I do, you know, a lot of solo concerts, it's well, yeah, maybe I can just walk away. Well, it's not something that
works
really.
Structure of these drum solos, like the saying, I follow and I agree with what you're saying. And it comes down to the mechanics of what you actually want to perform. And probably also you have to discern the question of Michel poses. Is that how you perform the whole piece? Or something that you have actually studied? I think you are tapping from your own resources to perform your piece. It's different routes that you are actually following.
I just think that more in terms of, I mean, you can be analytical and be hyper aware of what you're doing, or you can be analytical and self-judgmental. I think it's more whether you have that judgment sense. I mean, when I'm performing in the conversation mode, the things don't go how I expect. I mean, that's very much something I draw upon. The performance in the same way as technical performance, if I'm doing something with technology that doesn't, you know, unless completely, you know, but if it doesn't do exactly what I want it to, or if it's not working, I don't necessarily think that that is completely bad thing at the moment, so that simply is something I can deal with, and I can analyze what's going on without actually being thinking that this is something that I did wrong or did not work out ahead of time. Something that just happened.
Well, I'm not talking about mistakes or something. I'm just talking about states of mind. You know, problems occur all the time. You know, in choices, technically, attention of the audience, whatever. You know, concentration flows. Anyway, it's not the thing you control completely. I like working with that, you know, fighting to really deal with what's happening in that place at that moment, and so things aren't really going wrong at the time. I only have a problem of switching between these states of mind. That's what I'm trying to explain. And my music suffers, you know, if I can't have the right state of mind, if I'm distracted.
But not necessarily. I mean, you think you're losing yourself in it, and the whole audience will tell you about that which is really normal.
Oh, but that happens all the time.
Yeah.
No, I mean the other way around. If I feel good, quite often the music wasn't that good, you know. It's they want us to suffer. But it has come up. My mom, Muhammad Ali, has said the same thing, you know. They didn't want to see the problem. Part of
the to me, it's a system that gets after their life. I encountered this problem more or less everywhere when I built super fires on the edge of the base. And especially with the top of base, I used to take the base the wrong way, and I had this really heavy injury in my house. And after a while, I don't take the top base better, but I got so analytic about it.
Machines are like us.
Yeah, and I do believe that the reason is that if you have this analytical then you're constantly comparing the input to the output, and this is causing it to be less. So if I go on a little base, and I'm like, okay, the time is good from here, and I try to correct it, my correction is always better. So I don't, I lose this immediacy always.
Maybe there's two things being talked about. One of these is conflict, what David described, the media system like that. Maybe there's also a place we want to go to, some people want to go to, which is something other than this ordinary experience, that issue kind of romantic, the shamanistic issue or the spiritual issue. But some people see one way of getting there, some people see another way of getting there. Maybe that's the difference. How do you get to that place?
Do you think it's something about the nature of the materials that you're working with? If you improvise with another human being, then maybe you can perceive the interaction, the situation in a non-analytical way. But when you work with a machine, the only way that you can really get a grip on what it is it's doing, contributing to the situation, is by using that analytical thought process. And so it's that that is kind of interposing us.
In terms of instability, machines are slightly more stable than human beings, in my opinion. And I love working with both. No, that's not true. I think Roman had a question.
Well, I was going to say that it sounds, I mean, I agree with you that self-consciousness is, for me as a performer, is very destructive to my performance. But maybe there's a kind of consciousness that is not self-consciousness. And whether we call it awareness or whatever, and I mean, even in the most kind of mystical sense, I mean, I've had experiences where I've become so totally at one with the performance that suddenly I've been able to, there's been this like, it's kind of like, I've been watching it and saying to myself, like, wow, look at that. And here he comes, the other guy. And of course, I'm doing it, but if I ever said to myself, I'm doing it, Where's your left hand? You know, and yet at the same time, I know there's enough awareness to, you know, if something dropped, I would have caught it. So there's maybe there's a distinction to be made then between consciousness of self and consciousness of it in a greater sense. Somebody has to say it, so I don't know. But I find it interesting that we're kind of ending on that topic, because there is a very famous essay that I was talking to someone about last night called On the Marionette Theater by Heinrich von Kleist, written in the early 19th century, which is about this very problem. And basically Kleist's, I mean, it's a short essay, and it would do justice to it by reducing it to 25 words or less, but basically his position is that through that self-consciousness is the loss of innocence, in a sense, and is it's an impossible artistic perfection is achievable only through the loss of self-consciousness. And he makes and sort of creates an equivalency between the wild animal, the bear in that case, and puppet, or and he sees the puppet very much as a machine or a puppet in some ways. It's like a pendulum, and he's saying that in for the human being, he's talking about the dancer, the human being to achieve that state is the road to perfection, which means, you know, sort of making yourself, I mean, to my mind, it's, you know, putting yourself in sync or at one with the rhythm or whatever of the moment. But it does imply a forgetfulness of self, a loss of
Lanscombe said something about where work is slightly different, which is often to either improvise materials or to find materials. And I'm saying about the studio working analytically. And for me, there's this kind of balance between if you work completely analytically, you start off with some theoretical idea about what you want to make. In my experience, these things tend not to be rich. The fact is, you can't think about all the things that you're involved in making interesting time or interesting music, not consciously. And by improvising or going and finding things, I pick up things either in the world or in myself, which I don't know about, which are culturally conveyed or psychologically conveyed. Things that, if I try to construct them from first principles, would be absurd. But on the other hand, video recording and say, well, okay, I was really getting off on this when I did it, but is it really interesting? So there's an interplay between those two things. I'm just lack self-confidence. I like that in the sense. I know that when I try to be terribly analytic in making that very that image of the composer, I get terribly hung up and I can't do anything because in the end you can't control everything. But if I go to the other extreme and try to be a total improviser, I start worrying, well, am I just sort of wanking off? Do other people get off on this? And it's getting that balance right.
Well, the good thing about the technology now is that you can, with the software that's being developed, that you can work at home or in a studio and prepare all these sounds, and also even prepare structural processes, and then on stage you can start controlling them. So there is a way,
I think, to
control both, because it's great to be in a quiet place without people around you and really focus on the structural work.
Gets you out of science again, but gets you into something else more interesting. And this is the idea of what is mind like, which really expands, if you consider the idea of a machine being possibly mind like, which is what's happening in the last 30 years, then you also should consider other kinds of mind like things. And I think a quote from Gregory Bateson, which is, he said that wherever there is sufficient complexity, a mind will arise. And when we talk about extraterrestrial exploration, I'm talking about sort of like large complex systems on the Earth. We have no way of communicating with them. They don't have language. We don't have first contact. We don't have, I mean, it's really like, what's a rainforest? It's a large complex, a very large complex system, which appears to have behavior, appears to find likeness. And yet we have no way of making first contact. So actually the issue, I mean, when Roman said people are talking about humans being more like machines, you were talking about this tendency. I actually think maybe it's going the other way around, that our conception of what a machine is drifting towards us.
And
the last thing I want to say is that I want to rule out any sort of algorithmic machine, a machine that has predefined categories that follow some sort of
structure. This is perfect for the idea of composition, the idea of composing this person who intends to make these connects, to explain why he made it, and understand and control completely, as opposed to the idea of improvising musicians.
grasp that acquires gesture is being assumed by some aspect of the cortical function, as opposed to an idle gesture, as opposed to an extremely conscientious laborious gesture. So he's working with people who are skilled in drawing and who are being asked to do acquired things and being asked to do extremely deliberate things and idle things. And so he's working out the cortical mapping processes that go along with this neural pattern. But he would be first to say, well, so what? I've got a good map, I've got a good neural network. I can tell you what the pieces are. But the important thing is how these pieces work together.
Much before I was born.
myself as one of those people. I'm just trying to say that there is a literature out there that might be to investigate it. And what starts to find is that when we consider these kinds of issues, everyone seems comfortable with discussing their own notions of what that might entail, but there seems to be no background for it in terms of like whether or not there are actual people who have experienced this or have things to say about it. And that in place of that, we kind of get romanticizing of the presumed states of consciousness of various people. It could be primitive musicians or it could be wild bears. It doesn't really matter. It's the same image as far as I can see. And it comes from the same place, I think, in terms of the cultural consciousness. This is the thing that really I think I was trying to figure out what made me uncomfortable about this. And what made me uncomfortable about it was that normally I tend to, in terms of the music that I come from, I tend to be fit pretty routinely in terms of European consciousness with the wild bear or kind of the musician category. So that I started to think, well, a lot of this feels very personal to me in a way that I don't feel like it's necessarily more. Thing that I was wondering about here, which is the extent to which we can, now there are such things, we can point out that there is literature to refer to, but even a lot of that literature tended to do what we've heard a lot about here, which is to somehow make the claim that in order to actually enter the state of that to really do it, one has to lose oneself and lose the notion of so-called analytic consciousness or whatever. And it seems to me that we don't have a lot of cases to support that because most of the people who we would want to ask to know about that have in fact not been asked what they think about it. So, and my experience asking people is that they can tell you. And we don't have to speculate or pretend or sort of look at them and say, well, you seem to be in the past here, sir. So this is the actual issue that I've got. And it just seems as though there are people. We all improvise in our daily lives, and I'm just saying that we could all speak from our own experiences. And I think that it might be necessary for us to, and part of the reason for having conferences which have a very diverse range of people that, and metiers like the ones we have here, is so that we can benefit from the full range of experiences that people have, and so we're just going to have that full range of experiences, but at the same time, I would just like to point out that you do have to somehow, at a certain point, refer to those people who tend to get erased in these discussions. And that's sort of, maybe that's my kind of feeling about this. I mean, I was starting to get a little nervous with the idea that, that basically, that these different kinds of consciousness couldn't coexist. And that we had to either choose one and choose one or the other. And then, of course, I would say that my point of view is that I feel pretty angry sometimes. I think about everything from one of my passions that does what while I'm working, while the music is going on. I'm sorry if that's just how it is. I can't help it if that means I'm damned to hell for eternity, so be it. But it just seems that if we're going to have a party line on that, I just wanted to be, as I often am, in the minority. I would like to have as many modes of consciousness as possible in with regard to what I do, and that other people are free to feel as they would like to feel while they're doing their part.
Well, I feel I need to be something into this because you are bringing up categorizations that I don't feel are connected to at all. To begin with, I haven't used the word categorization as a description of what I do. I also very unclear what happens. People are, you know, sticking to their desktops, and these new performers, they really jump in it in a way that they're there, that they're not thinking about their systems as much as we are. I'm trying to show, you know, that that's another way of being in touch with the audience as well, and that means you're connecting with the people in the hall. I'm not trying to be consciously chosen to raise this subject as my personal survival problem, and not as any party line or whatever. I mean, you know that there's enough variety in people in this room already, and in another thing. So I'm a bit bitter if you start using party line words in this respect, because I think it's very good to see that there are people now starting to use all this equipment that a lot of us have developed in a way as, you know, as in my opinion, legal performers are doing. And I like that. I like what has been built up on stage. You know, this whole tradition of actors that can really, you know, get the audience into their grip and have a relationship with the audience and communicate with the audience. And that needs a concentration that goes away from thinking about your gear alone. And I'm not at all talking about the fact that you can't make decisions about your music on stage. I mean, if that is improvising, yes, then I'm with you. But to make these decisions, you have to be in it, you know, and it has a lot to do with physicality. That's why I think it's so important that we talk about it, because it's a kind of physical consciousness almost. And that's
I'm sorry, back to what Tim, what we said yesterday, when you perform, you make dragon from the spot here, and you start raising your toes, and you start closing your eyes, and you're heading to that spot all the time, and then when something happens, and something goes wrong, whether you dwell on that moment, then you have to catch up to the rest of you, have to take a sideways step, and then start going towards you again, but sometimes, with no sideways step, you really hit that. And we talked about golf, because I used to play lots of golf, and it's such a great comparison, because you can hit thousands of strokes, why the hell can you hit one so good, and the rest not? And then, loads and loads of rounds, and one round is just like poetry. And it's when you say physical consciousness, maybe I think it's called unconsciousness. Whereby it flows, it moments, we use the moment, we absorb all that moment. Just stop that flow. It's my own feeling of it.
Thank you.
difficult to explain something to the human and instrument and being the form and the sense that he's talking about. I can't a little bit understand that sort of difference, but it is a function that always goes on when you're on stage and you're always listening to the people that you're talking about. But it is a sense of that you yourself, as a unity, as an instrument, as a form, you're using yourself, and that's some sort of strange thing to say, but yourself and using it are two words that are very connected. Yeah, well, it's that. She said that as a suggestive thing, and we can do something much more, much larger. Yeah, no, just simply, it's larger. It's hard to I understand the difference that it's going on. I mean, it's like feeling all those processes that go on and on and on. So it's separate, but in the same moment, it's also